dear students, today we are meeting to resume our chapter "We Are Not Afraid to Die If We Can All Be Together." So let's start today's discussion.
So last time we stopped our discussion here till this paragraph, okay, where we had come to know that there were no replies to their signals, that over the radio they were making the mayday calls and no replies were given to them, as they were in the remotest part of the world. And Sue's head was now more swollen and had two back eyes, like she had back two eyes with a deep cut in her arm. So when, upon being asked why she didn't tell him about her injuries earlier, she said that she didn't want to worry her father, as he was trying to save all of them. So after this, we will move ahead in the next paragraph. By morning on January 3rd, the pumps had the water level sufficiently under control for us to take 2 hours rest in rotation. But we still had a tremendous leak somewhere below the water line, and on checking, I found that nearly all the boats. He further says that we had survived for 15 hours since the wave hit, but wave walker wouldn't hold together long enough for us to reach Australia. I checked our charts and calculated that there were two small islands a few hundred kilometers to the east. One of them, Isle Amsterdam, was a French scientific base. Our only hope was to reach these pinpricks in the vast ocean. But unless the wind and seas abated so we could hoist sail, our chances would be slim indeed. The great wave had put our auxiliary engine out of action. So as he is telling you here that the water level was under control by the morning of January 3rd, so all of them took 2 hours rest in rotation. But there still was a leak somewhere below the water line. Okay. And upon checking, the boat rib structure was badly broken till the base of the ship, and the whole section of starboard was held together with a few cupboard partitions. As he's writing here that the rib frames were smashed down to the keel. Smashed means badly broken, and keel here stands for the steel structure along the base of the ship. Okay, so the ship condition was so bad that it would not make it till Australia. And the narrator checked the charts and calculated that there were two small islands a few kilometers to the east, and one of them was Isle Amsterdam, which was a French scientific base earlier, but their only hope was to search and reach that island, but only if the wind and the sea do not cause further damage, else their chances were very slim, very less to reach this island. So the wave had destroyed the ship's auxiliary engine also. So that is why he is calculating here that his chance to reach in this island was minimum. Now on January 4th, after 36 hours of continuous pumping, we reached the last few centimeters of water. Now we had only to keep pace with the water still coming in. We could not set any sail on the main mast. Pressure on the rigging would simply pull the damaged section of the hull apart, so we hoisted the storm jib and headed for where I thought the two islands were. Mary found some corned beef and cracker biscuits, and we ate our first meal in almost 2 days. So here the narrator is telling that after 36 hours of continuous pumping on January 4th, the water was only a few centimeters left to be pumped out, but they still had to pump out the water which was coming in. and they could not set sail on the main mast, and they hoisted the storm jib and sailed towards the two small islands. And they had their first meal in 2 days, some corned beef and cracker biscuits found by Mary. Okay. Next is, but our respite was short-lived. At 4 p.m., black clouds began building up behind us, and within the hour, the wind was back to 40 knots and the seas were getting higher. The weather continued to deteriorate throughout the night, and by dawn on January 5th, our situation was again desperate. So the rest period was short-lived as black clouds built up around 4 p.m. and the wind was now 40 knots and the sea was getting higher. The weather got worse, and by the early morning of January 5th, the situation was bad. When I went in to comfort the children, John asked, "Daddy, are we going to die?" I tried to assure him that we could make it. "But Daddy," he went on, "we are not afraid of dying if we can all be together. You and Mummy, Sue and I." So this paragraph is very touching, where the narrator is informing you that what his son had said to him, you know. And the lines which is said by his son, John, you know, Jonathan, is the title of the chapter. We are afraid of dying. We are not afraid of dying if we can all be together. So very touching lines and full of hope. Okay. So when the narrator went to comfort his children, his son asked him whether they were going to die, and he tried to assure him that they would make it. So his son replied that they were not afraid to die till they all are together. And this filled the narrator with the determination to fight back. And he further says, "I could find no words with which to respond. But I left the children's cabin determined to fight the sea with everything I had. Everything I had here stands for whatever stamina, strength, courage and hope had left within him." You know, he wanted to make more and more efforts with that courage. "To protect the weakened starboard side, I decided to heave to with the undamaged port hull facing the oncoming waves. Using an improvised sea anchor of heavy nylon rope and two 22-liter plastic barrels of paraffin. That evening, Mary and I sat together holding hands as the motion of the ship brought more and more water in through the broken planks. We both felt the end was very near." So he made efforts to protect the weakened starboard side. He used an improvised sea anchor made of heavy nylon rope and two 22-liter plastic barrels of kerosene or paraffin. And that same evening, the narrator and his wife sat holding hands, and they believed that their end was near. He further says that, "But Wave Walker rode out the storm, and by the morning of January 6th, with the wind easing, I tried to get a reading on the sextant. Back in the chart room, I worked on wind speeds, changes of course, drift and current in an effort to calculate our position. The best I could determine was that we were somewhere in 150,000 kilometers of ocean, looking for a 65-kilometer wide island. While I was thinking, Sue, moving painfully, joined me. The left side of her head was now very swollen and her blackened eyes narrowed to slits. She gave me a card she had made. On the front, she had drawn caricatures of Mary and me with the words, "Here are some funny people. Did they make you laugh?" I laughed a lot as well. Inside was a message. "Oh, how I love you both." So this card is to say thank you and let's hope for the best. Somehow we had to make it. So somehow the ship made it through the storm, and by the morning of January 6th, the narrator tried to get reading on the sextant. Now sextant is an instrument with the graduated arc of 60 degrees for taking altitudes and navigation. Okay. So the narrator had worked with wind speeds, drift and current and calculated their position, and he found that they were in somewhere, you know, 150,000 kilometers area of ocean, and they were searching for the 65 kilometer wide island. And while the narrator was still thinking, his daughter Sue joined him, and she was in a great pain. And the left side of her head was swollen and her blackened eyes had narrowed down to slits. And she gave him a card which she had made herself. And on the front of the card was a cartoon image. You know, caricatures, as he has used the word caricatures here. Okay, it means that the pictures of a person or cartoon. Okay. So she had made a cartoon image of her parents with words written about them and being funny people and how they made her laugh. And on the inside of the card, she told them how she loved them both and she thanked them. This made the narrator realize that they had to make it to the island. Now he further tells us that I checked and rechecked my calculations. We had lost our main compass and I was using a spare which had not been corrected for magnetic variation. I made an allowance for this and another estimate of the influence of the westerly currents which flow through this part of the Indian Ocean. About 2 p.m. I went on deck and asked Larry to steer a course of 185 degrees. If we were lucky, I told him with a conviction I did not feel, he could expect to see the island at about 5 p.m. Then with a heavy heart, I went below, climbed on my bunk and amazingly dozed off. When I woke, it was 6 p.m. and growing dark. I knew we must have missed the island, and with the sail, we had left. We couldn't hope to beat back into the westerly winds. At that moment, a tousled head appeared by my bunk. "Can I have a hug?" Jonathan asked. Sue was right behind him. So as he is telling you here that he rechecked his calculations and they lost their main compass and were using the spare one which was not corrected for magnetic variations, and he estimated the influence of the westerly currents which flow through the Indian Ocean. And around 2 p.m. He went on deck and asked Larry to steer the wheel to 185 degrees. And he felt that if we were lucky, they would see the island by 5 p.m. Then he went below and slept. He woke up around 6 p.m. and it was dark outside. And he thought that they might have missed the island. He started worrying about how they would tackle the westerly wind more, as the ship wasn't capable to sail more. And right at this moment, his son came and asked him for a hug. And his daughter was also there. Then he asked, "Why am I getting a hug now?" I asked. "Because you are the best daddy in the whole world and the best captain," my son replied. "Not today, John, I'm afraid." "Why, you must be," said Sue in a matter-of-fact voice. "You found the island." "What?" I shouted. It's out there in front of us, they chorused, as big as a battleship. I rushed on deck and gazed with relief at the stark outline of Isle Amsterdam. It was only a bleak piece of volcanic rock with little vegetation, the most beautiful island in the world. So when he was hugged by his son, he asked that why was he getting a hug? And his son replied that he was the best daddy in the world and also called him the best captain. And the narrator replied that he was afraid. So you told then that they had found the island, which was as big as a battleship. So the narrator rushed to the deck and gave a sigh of relief. They could see the complete outline of Isle Amsterdam. And there was a bleak piece of volcanic rock in front of them. Now, bleak here means, as the word bleak is used here, you know, it was only a bleak piece. Bleak here means an area of land lacking vegetation. Okay, so you know, he gazed with relief at the stark outline of Isle Amsterdam. Stark here means sharply defined. So he could clearly see the defining line, the outer edge of the Isle Amsterdam. So there was a bleak piece of volcanic rock and it had a little vegetation also. And according to him, it was the most beautiful island in the world. Then he says, we anchored offshore for the night, and the next morning all 28 inhabitants of the island cheered as they helped us ashore. With land under my feet again, my thoughts were full of Larry and Herbie, cheerful and optimistic under the direst stress, and of Mary, who stayed at the wheel for all those crucial hours. Most of all, I thought of a 7-year-old girl who did not want us to worry about a head injury, which subsequently took 6 minor operations to remove a recurring blood clot between skin and skull, and of a 6-year-old boy who was not afraid to die. So here they moored the ship at some distance from the shore, and the next morning 28 inhabitants of the Amsterdam island helped them to move on the shore of the island. And as he felt and land again on his feet, he thought of his crewmen and his wife. He also thought of his 7-year-old daughter who was injured badly. She had to go through 6 minor operations and to remove the blood clot in her head. And his son, who never gave up and was not afraid to die because he believed that we all are together. So basically, children's hope was a great help to the narrator. And he had tried his best and had made his great efforts to save the whole family. So here the emotional bonding of the family can be easily seen. And you know, they bonded together, they worked together as the near tragedy drew them closer together. And the whole situation described in the chapter shows that they were not willing to give in to danger, but they were ready to battle it. And till the end, they were optimistic about finding the Isle Amsterdam and steered the ship towards that direction. And their optimism paid off and they came out of a stressful situation. So this is the lesson that we get from this chapter. Now this chapter has ended here, dear children. And in the next video, we shall discuss the question answer of this chapter. Till then, goodbye.